رب العالمين، الصلاة والسلام على سيد الأولين والآخرين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My dear respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
جزاكم الله خير. Welcome brothers and sisters, إن شاء الله in this course, which is very, very valuable, it's very important because it's related to the knowledge of the Quran. And the ulama said, شرف العلم من شرف المعلوم. شرف العلم من شرف المعلوم. The noblest or the noble or the high status of the type of knowledge or the honor of any type of knowledge depends on what this knowledge talk about. And all we know that this knowledge that we are going inshallah to share is related to the book of Allah Azza wa Jal, which is, you know, the words of Allah Azza wa Jal, the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, no honor, in fact, for any other type or fields of knowledge more than this and the knowledge of the Aqidah, which is teach us about our creator, our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, I would like you, in fact, encourage myself first and encourage you to continue for attending this series of classes. And whenever you miss anything because of any reason, because this course will last for about 8 months, that means it will go till the time of Ramadan, inshallah. We will meet every Saturday, inshallah. May Allah Azza wa Jal give us all life and strength to continue this noble, inshallah. And in case that you miss anything, you will find it, inshallah, recorded either in my page in the Facebook or in the YouTube, be there, inshallah. It's very important to continue and to make summary and try to read and go back to whatever you learn. This course, my dear brothers and sisters, is very important. Why? Because it will learn it about many things about the Quran. Many Muslims, they know the Quran is the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. They know that they recite the Quran. The Quran is the guidance. All these things, general knowledge. But the more that you know about the Quran and about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more will be strengthen your faith, your belief, will keep you always in the straight path and firm and in yaqeen. Therefore, it is very important to have the knowledge of the Quran, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he sent the Quran down to us, he mentioned that the purpose of this Quran not to hang it in walls or write it in walls, for example, as they do sometimes, or to put it as a copy in your car or at your home in the shelf just to bring barakah, as some people they do. There is no question, there is barakah in the Quran. But this is not the purpose of the Quran. The purpose of the Quran, as Allah Azza wa Jalla said, لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِ. This blessed book that was revealed to you, O Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, for what? For what? لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِ. That means to look in deep and deep understanding for all these verses. Therefore, it's very important to understand the Quran, to know the text, and to know the tafsir, we need to know what the different science is related to the Quran, because the Muslim scholars they took good care of the book of Allah Azza wa Jal throughout the generations, for many years, many generations. So today, inshallah, this meeting will be an introduction. And before we go to the introduction or the main topic of our class today, let me go over with you very quick over some, or what do you call it, the overline of the our class. So we will start, inshallah, series of lessons in Tafsir, which will start with Surah Al-Fatiha, بإذن الله عز وجل. Today we will have introduction in the Quran, the status of the Quran, and the sciences of the Quran, different sciences. Maybe many of you, they didn't hear that there is sciences, not only one science of the Quran. There is Tafsir, there is Tajweed, there is Ahkam, all these, inshallah, we'll talk about it. Next week, inshallah, we'll have another introduction, which is very important to put the foundation for our understanding for the Quran, which is introduction in the Tafsir of the introduction on the foundation, the rules, the methodology, the conditions of understanding and interpretation of the Quran. And then, inshallah, we'll start in Surah Al-Fatiha. Now, what's the way that we'll follow in the guideline that we'll follow in our tafsir, inshallah? Talk about the name of the surah, because there is some surah which has more than one name, like Bara'a, it has a name called At-Tawbah. Al-Isra had another name called Bani Israel. So we'll talk about the name, and if there's any reason for this name was mentioned. And then we'll talk about if there's any reasons or any causes for the revelation of the surah, or the revelation of some of the ayat or the verses in the surah. This is why we call it Asbab al-Nuzul. Then we'll talk about also, we'll mention, inshallah, the place where this surah was revealed, or verses. Was it Makkah or was it in Medina? And then we'll talk about the general theme, the main theme of this surah in general. And then we'll talk about some of the virtue of the surah, because there are certain surah, it has certain virtues, the same as there is, or there are some ayat, some verses which has certain virtue based on what was reported from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then we'll talk in the interpretation of the ayat. We'll take the ayat and we'll interpret it, inshallah. We'll explain it, we'll explain the meaning, we'll give inshallah the meaning or the tafsir. And in this way, we'll start with tafsir al-Quran bil-Quran, to interpret the ayah or the best, if there's any interpretation for the same ayah in the Quran itself. And then we'll go to the next stage for how it was, if it was explained by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then we'll go to the saying of the Sahaba radhiyallahu alayhim, and so on. And then we'll end with ahkam, rules, what types of rules we learn from these verses, and how can we apply it in our life. And then the last one, which is what do we benefit, or many of the benefits or the application of these verses in our life. This, inshallah, the outline of the way of our course. And I hope by the end, inshallah, of this course, you will be equipped with very valuable knowledge in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then at least if you just understood Surah Al-Fatiha and learn about Surah Al-Fatiha, that's great achievement. And maybe this Surah Al-Fatiha, maybe we'll spend more than a few weeks, few meetings, because it is very rich. It is deep ma'ani, meanings in this great surah that we repeat it every time, at least the minimum 17 times in our day, which is in Salat Al-Fariq. Let's go now to our main topic today. I will share with you this. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I will share with you this PowerPoint. I hope that it will work with me. I'm not very truly. Yani. Bismillah. طيب. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. طيب. So here, as you see, we'll start with talking about, this is the title of our subject today, the Quran and the sciences of the Quran. That means we have more than one science relates to the knowledge of the Quran, and this is what we will explain, inshallah. طيب. The Quran. Now, what is the definition of the Quran? Now, if you ask any Muslim, what is the Quran? He will say, the Quran is the word of Allah. No question. It is the word of Allah Azza wa Jal. And every Muslim knows this. And even the non-Muslim, they know that the Quran, according to Muslim, is the word of Allah Azza wa Jal. But here, as a student of knowledge, we need to go back and learn this, knowledge that was mentioned or founded by our scholar. So the Quran, the meaning of the Quran, it has two meaning, in fact. It has two meaning. Now, the Quran, what they call it, the very short definition, simple definition, and the detailed, the more explained definition. Now, what is the definition of the Quran? Now, before we go to the difference between Quran and Hadith Qudsi, the definition of the Quran, as I said, there are two definitions. One is simple and short. And this most scholars, whatever you read, you know, and the saying or the lectures, or you hear the lectures of the ulama, always they mention this very simple short one. The short definition of the Quran is هو كلام الله الذي المنزل على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم والمتعبد بتلاوته. Three things. كلام الله منزل على محمد نتعبد الله بتلاوته. It is the word of Allah, it is the speech of Allah that was revealed to Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, and we worship Allah عز وجل by our recitation for this book. This is the short, clear definition of the Quran. So the Quran is the word or the speech of Allah Azza wa Jal to Muhammad, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we worship Allah Azza wa Jal by recitation of this book. And we'll tell you why they mention this recitation here. It will come in detail in the more detail, general or in detail definition. Now, the detailed definition, it said like this. هو كلام الله. هو كلام الله سبحانه وتعالى. المنزل على محمد المعجز. المعجز. المنزل على قلب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. بواسطة جبريل عليه السلام والمتعبد بتلاوته والمبدوء بسورة الفاتحة ومختوم بسورة الناس. It is a long definition, but it includes everything about the Quran. Now let's take it one by one. هو كلام الله, the speech of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. المعجز, the miraculous. That means this book, it's not like any other book, but there it is miracle. How come? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged the people during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to produce only one chapter. He asked him to produce one Quran and then 10 chapter and then one chapter, and they were not be able to do this. This is why Allah Azza wa Jal said, قُلْ لَإِنْ اجْتَمَعَتِ الْإِنْسُ وَالْجِنُ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَأْتُوا بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ ظَهِيرًا. This is Surah Al-Isra, which means that if the whole jinn and ins get together to produce one like this Quran, they will not be able to do so. Even they were supporter of each other. So this is when we talk Al-Mu'jid, that's mean which is the miraculous book of Allah Azza wa Jal. And also it said, Al-Mu'jiz المنزل على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. So now we are the Because if you say it is the word of Allah, the miracles, you know, then maybe there are other words of Allah Azza wa Jal, which is the Torah was revealed to Musa alayhi salam. The Injil was revealed to Isa alayhi salam. So when we say Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that means this refers to whom? To which one of the books of Allah refers to the Quran? The Quran, na'am. And then it said, Al-Muta'abbadu bitilawatihi. That means we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Jibreel alayhi salam. Through Jibreel. Biwasitati Jibreel. Through Jibreel. Why we say through Jibreel here? Because there is revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came to the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through other ways, sometimes through dreams, sometimes direct speech. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ascended to the seventh heaven, and then Allah azza wa jal commanded him for these five prayers, Allah azza wa jal talked or spoke to him directly. This is not part of the Quran. It's not come through Jibreel alayhi wa sallam. So only the word Allah that was come through the revelation that come through Jibreel alayhi salam, this will be considered as the Quran. This is why Azza wa Jal said, "Nazala bihi wa-innahu la-tanzilu Rabbil Alameen." This is a revelation from the Lord of the Lords. "Nazala bihi ar-ruh al-amin." Ar-ruh al-amin. The Holy Ghost, Jibreel alayhi salam, ala qalbika litakuna min al-mundirin. So it has come to this Quran, come to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, through the Holy Ghost, that Jibreel alayhi salam. Another point also regarding to this, why we say it through Jibreel, as I mentioned, because hadith Qudsi, for example, which is meaning from Allah and the words from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But when we talk also, it is said, al-muta'abbadu bitalawati. That means it worship Allah by reciting its verses. Because if you recite Hadith Qudsi, which is also word from Allah, Kalam Allah, and the Prophet always reported, said, Allah said, Allah said, which said, and we'll talk about the Hadith Qudsi later. But if you read it, we'll not get hasana, you know, for every letter. But for the Quran only, every time you recite the Quran, you get for every letter, every alphabetical letter, you get ten hasanat, and may Allah Azza wa Jalla apply to whom He wants. And then it said, "Al-Mabdu'i bi Surat al-Fatiha." This the book which was start or which start with Surat al-Fatiha, the opening chapter, and end with Surat al-Nas. That means between Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen till Surah, the end of Surah An-Nas. من شر الوسواس الخناس الذي يوسوس في صدور الناس من الجنة والناس. This is the last word in the Quran. So this word between these two surah is the Quran. So I hope this explanation is very, very clear. I know it is long, but at least now you understand. You have better understanding to the meaning, the definition of the Quran, because you, it's very important for the Muslim. This is your book. This is your guide. So it is really a shame that a Muslim, he doesn't know that much about the book of guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to him. Right. The next point is the difference between the Quran and Hadith Qudsi. Why we should mention this? Because some people, you know, when you say the word of Allah and it's come to Hadith Qudsi and said, how come it said here the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, قال الله تعالى. Like, for example, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the hadith, من عاد لي وليا, or the hadith which is very famous, and we know it in Ramadan, he said, قال الله تعالى, الصوم لي وأنا أجزي بك. Fasting is for me, and I am the one who will give its reward. Now this, this is the word of Allah. Now what's the difference between this and the word of Allah, which is, we call it Quran? That the word in the Quran, it is the exact word of Allah, the exact speech of Allah. That means Allah Azza wa Jal spoke this words and said this word. This is why we said always when we make any quote, we say, Aqala ta'ala. Allah said. Now, when we come to Al-Hadith Al-Qudsi, قدسي حديث. علماء have two views. Some of them they say this is the word and the meaning from Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Others they said the meaning from Allah, but it was said or expressed by the prophetic word, by the word of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. This is why we try to mention this to make it clear for you. Now, when we talk about brief revelation of the Quran, most of us, we know this. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام in Mecca for 40 years, never say one verse of the Quran. When he reached the age of 40, he was in Ghar Hira. He received the first five verses of the Quran, which is the first five verses of Surah Al-Alaq. اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من العلق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. These are the first five verses that was revealed of the Quran to the Prophet after he reached the age of 40. And then after this, the Quran start to come and continue for 23 years. So the Quran was not revealed at once to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, but it was come gradually. Sometimes a surah, sometimes one verse, sometimes more, depending on many reasons. We'll talk about it when we talk about the tafsir of the Quran. And for 23 years. And this is the Quran. It was in Medina, in Mecca, and then continue to Medina. This is why we have what they call it the Quran Makki, the Quran Madani. That's mean Meccan verses and Medini or Medina verses. We'll talk about this inshallah later on by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. Let me just explain get here this one. Yeah. Now we'll go to the next point, which is very important. Sciences of the Quran. We talk at the beginning, we say this is the Quran. Now, what do we mean by sciences of the Quran? Because there are, my dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide the Muslim scholars to take good care of every aspect of the Quran, Al-Karim. Every aspect. It's recitation, it is revelation, the place that was revealed, the causes why it was revealed, the rules that's come, the stories or the history of the previous nation. So many different sciences related to the Quran. And then this, you know, knowledge, because it was accumulated, so it's become, we have some specialists. So we have specialists in Tajweed, specialists, And for example, in the meaning or tafsir, a specialist in the reason or the cause of revelation. And this is what you call it, the sciences of the Quran. So the science of the Quran, or they call it ulum al-Quran, ulum, sciences, from ilm, ilm is one, ulum, plural, al-Quran. It is what? The knowledge of ulum al-Quran is, in reality, the knowledge that one is required to know in order to properly interpret the Quran. This is why we started with this, which means that the person who doesn't have good background in all these fields of knowledge, then he will not be able to give tafsir for the Quran. And in fact, he's not eligible. That he can give the right tafsir. So this is, it's very important. This is like tools that one, the scholar, the student's knowledge need to acquire and to have before he start to make any tafsir or interpretation for the Quran. But what are the subjects that's included in the science of the Quran? As we said, these many. The first one is the recitation. One of the signs of the Quran is the knowledge of tilawati. Ilmu tilawati. Recitation. how to recite it, where to stop, where to start, where to make the, you see, idgham, or this what they call it, ulama tajweed. So this is science. We know that there is single subject called tajweed, and there are some classes for tajweed. So tajweed, in fact, it is teach the correct way to recite the Quran as it was reported from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This, my dear brothers and sisters, with learning the Quran, it is very unique way to learn and memorize the Quran. Very unique, which means that no other knowledge or field of knowledge is better. What is it? That the Quran taking by listening. And this, what we call it, al-ijaza. This is why you have many of mashallah, students or some shuyukh who they took ijaza. What does it mean, ijaza? It does that mean he recite and learn the Quran, the pronunciation exactly with tajweed at the hand from well-skilled teacher who memorized the Quran and took it from other teacher behind before him. So at the end, he will give him later. He said, so and so recite the Quran in front of me. I taught him and recite it, you know, in the right way, the correct manner, keeping tajweed and all these things. How does he start this? He starts from the saying that he, from the beginning. This is why they find this person, he will be proud of this ijazah. He will say, why? Because it's mentioned that so-and-so, he took or learned the Quran from so-and-so to so-and-so, so-and-so, till it's come and reach the companion who took it from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So you have long chains of narrators. So this is what we call it tajweed. Also including in the recitation, what we call it al-qira'at. Now, qira'at, what does it mean? A different way of reading the Quran. And there is 7, and some ulama, they make it 10. And this is part, because the Prophet ﷺ approved this, and he said, أُنزِلَ الْقُرْآنُ عَلَى سَبْعَةِ أَحْدٍ. 7 way. And this doesn't make any change in the meaning, by the way. But subhanAllah, like for example, in some qira'ah, in Surah Al-Fatiha, we said, Maliki Yawmiddin. And the other one we said, Maliki Yawmiddin. And both give the same meaning, almost. Or in Surah Al-Hujurat, Fatabayyanu. Some days read it, Fatathabbatu. Or even sometimes in the way, in Tajweed, for example, like when you read, for example, Al-Duha, we said, الضحى والليل إذا سجى. This is the recitation through عاصم. Another, maybe you hear some of those reciter, maybe you surprised. He said, instead of said والضحى, he said والضحي والليل إذا سجى. So there's different قراءات. So this also included in the meaning or the part or the field of knowledge which is related to what? To recitation of the Quran. نعم. Also included in the science of the Quran, the history of the Quran. And this part deal with what? The stage of revelation, as I just give you very quick brief about it. And how the Quran reached us. Because we said that the time of the Prophet, the Messenger of Allah, he will hear it from Jibreel alayhi salam. And then he will recite it. And the Sahaba, the companion, will write it down. Some of them, they will write it down. And then, at the time of Abu Bakr Siddiq, radiallahu an, he collected all what was written, and they put it in order. So the Muslim that we have, in fact, it was prepared at the time of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu, when he was prepared, also included at the time of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because the Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wa sallam, used to review the Quran with Jibreel alayhi salam in every Ramadan. Jibreel alayhi salam come down in Ramadan at last nights of Ramadan and review the Quran with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi salam every year once. At the last year, before the death of the Prophet alayhi salam, he reviewed it twice with him, which means he put alayhi salam, our Prophet, he put the order of these verses, the order of this surah. So it was not done by any other, but it is a revelation. So the Prophet salam used to say, put this verse here, put this chapter here. So it was organized, you know, according to the revelation. At the time of Abu Bakr Siddiq, he collected this. But Uthman radiallahu anhu, at the time of Uthman, what he did, he took what was, you know, with Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, because Abu Bakr Siddiq, it was in the custody of Umar radiallahu anhu. Then Uthman radiallahu anhu, he sent to Hafsa to send him this collection of scripts that was collected for the Quran. And he called four of the best reciters and memorizers and scholars of the Sahaba, and they wrote it in one book. So this is, we talk about the history of the Quran. Now, also among the sciences of the Quran, the understanding and implementation of the Quran. And this is what we call it tafsir. Call it a tafsir. And this cover, as we said, one causes of revelation. What does it mean by causes? This is why they call it asbab and nizul. You see, because sometimes people ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then Allah azza wa jalla revealed answer for that question. يسألونك عن المحيط قل هو أذى. People they ask about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about certain matters. So come the answer. So this is what they call it, asbab al-nuzul. Sometimes talk about story. Like, for example, al-dihar. You know, the one who said to his wife, you are like the back of my mother. This because of a reason. Talk about al-mujahid. The woman who came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, argue with him about what her husband said to her. So there is asbab, or reason or causes for this, included in also one of the sciences of the Quran. Also, the knowledge of Makki and Madani. What do we mean by this? That means what are the verses that was revealed in Mecca, and what are those that was revealed in Medina? Because we know the Quran started in Mecca, continuing with the Prophet who spent 13 years in Mecca and 10 years in Medina. So the ulama, they follow these verses and they taught us, they transmit to us this knowledge. This certain verses was in Mecca, certain verses in Medina. But it's not, be careful. The ulama, they put general rule, guideline. They said, whatever revealed before the migration will be considered as Meccan. That means it was in Mecca. Whatever revealed of the verses of the Quran after the migration, it will be called Madani. What does this mean? That means even after the migration, like, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came to Mecca for Hajj or for Umrah, and there are some verses that was revealed to him in Mecca. But since he already migrated to Medina, they will consider this which was revealed in Mecca as Madani. And there is a certain character for, you know, the verses which was in Mecca or Medina, which is not our topic to talk about it here. Maybe sometimes come to this. Now, what, and also discover the knowledge of various form, ahruf, it was revealed. And we talk about this when we talk about Qira'at, understanding of its obligated ruling or verses. This is what they call it, al-nasikh wal-mansukh. Nasikh or mansukh. There are certain verses, and you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, revealed the Quran gradually to prepare the people to it. So there are some verses that come, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send other verses which abrogate the previous one. But for example, when you talk about al-khamr, alcohol, at the beginning, you know, يسألونك عن الخمر الميسر قل فيهما إثم كبير ومنافع للناس. And there is even some ulama, they say there is another verse with, before this, that تتخذون منه سكرا وزقا حسنا. And then it's come, don't approach salah at the time of when you are drunk. And then it's come the last ayah which make the alcohol forbidden. So this last ayah which made alcohol or al-khamr forbidden abrogated previous verses which talk about other matter, like, you know, don't come to the salah while you are drunk. So it's not nobody can come and say, well, the Quran said don't come while drunk, so in the salah I'm not going to drink, after the salah it's okay. No, this verse we said it is abrogated, that means it was changed and replaced by other verses which come after it. This is what you call it. So Wal-Mansukh. Also, discover the knowledge of the various classification of verses. You see, there is muhkam wa mutashabih. Muhkam, that means clear meaning. That nobody have any doubt about it, or no difference among ulama about it. Mutashabih, sometimes it could have to be understood in different way, or more understanding. But always the ulama, they said what? Whatever in the mutashabih, we retain it to the muhkam. So we take the muhkam as base, and then anything which has more than one meaning, then we interpret it based on other verses, which is very, very clear. Am and khas, general and special. What does this mean? You know, sometimes there are some verses that come for a certain reason or for a certain person. But this, sometimes, is it special or is it general? This is the knowledge of this. Like, for example, when we talk, one of the Sahaba, he said, I touch a woman. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed the ayah that if the one who pray, or I call now the ayah, but the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked him and said, did you pray with us? He said, yes, he said. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed ayah that said that in the hasanat, yudhibna sayyat. The good deeds will clear or wipe the bad deeds. So this was, it's come for a story for one man. This is what they call it khas, the sabab. The reason is special for this man. But the rule is what? General. Because he said, oh Prophet of Allah, is this just for me or for everyone? He said, for everyone. Which means that for all of us, whenever anyone of us, may Allah Azza wa Jal protect us, do anything wrong, just follow it with good deeds and it will be wiped by the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. And then the knowledge of its interpretation, and this is what we call it, علم التفسير, explanation of the meaning of the Quran. And this is our course in this area of the knowledge of the science of Quran. So I'm not going to talk about any of the other science of the Quran, of the ulum al-Quran. We will talk in one science, which is علم التفسير, and this is our, will be our topic. Right. Let's end here. Also, this related to the grammar. They call it Arab al-Quran. Arab, that's mean grammatical. There are some ulama who cared about the structure of the linguistic structure of the Quran. This they call it Arab al-Quran. And also the knowledge of word whose usage has become uncommon. They call it gharib al-Quran, strange word. What does this mean? There are certain word, it's not common usage, especially these days. Maybe people, when they hear it, they don't So the ulama, they took good care of collecting all these unknown or uncommon words and put it in certain books. So the student of knowledge, when he come across this word for him is strange, he will find it. It's like a dictionary for him to find out the meaning of this word. Now let's end with this. What do we benefit from studying Ulum Al-Quran? There are many benefits, my dear brothers and sisters. First of all, to realize the wealth of knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and subhanallah surround this great book, this great guidance, and take good care of this knowledge. Also, enable the student knowledge to better understanding of the Quran, as I said in my introduction. So he will be familiar with the revelation, the history, the collection, the rules, the linguistic structure, and all these things which is related to the Quran. Also, we learn from this, it is increased your faith. Why is it increased? The more you know of the Quran, the more you recite and know the meaning, this will encourage your heart, your mind to think and increase your faith. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَى. Barely, only those with knowledge fear Allah. Does this mean people, other people, they don't fear? Yes, they fear Allah. Muslim, any Muslim, he fear Allah. But the more you know Allah, the more you fear him, the more you have hope in him, the more you try to get closer to him. And what is the knowledge that gets you close to Allah Azza wa Jal more than his own words, his own speech, the Quran itself? Naam. Naam. Also from among, so he will understand the miraculous nature of the Quran. Many people, they don't realize the miraculous nature of the Quran. Some people, they care about, they call it their scientific, miracles. This means we talk about science, miracles in the area of science. But in Quran, subhanAllah, miracles in everything. When we talk about history, talk about old, previous nations, like Ad, Watamud, the people of Egypt, the Pharaoh, and talk about Lut, and then give you also, he tell you, go, there's places there, still there. وَأَنَّكُمْ لَتَمُرُّونَ مِهِمْ مُصْبِحِينَ وَبِاللَّيْلِ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. You pass by the lake or the Dead Sea where Allah punished the people of Lut. So this is miraculous also by itself. When the Quran, even the language, nobody can make one verse like the Quran. The way the miracles of Allah is to be memorized. So you have many of the people who memorize the Quran and they don't speak one word in Arabic. You find them in India, in the Philippines, in Sri Lanka, in Africa, everywhere. You recite the Quran from the cover to the cover, from his head. And if you ask him, how are you? Maybe you look at you and he doesn't know what you said to him. Subhanallah. Isn't this miracle by itself? That million, not one or two, million throughout the time of history who memorize the Quran, even they don't know the language of the Quran. More than this, very small, little children, 7 years old, 6 years old, 12 years old, they memorize the whole Quran. Subhanallah, this is miracles. And there's other miracles, miracles in rules and law. Find the law. How come? Yeah, subhanallah, one man who lived at the time of the Prophet, he can prepare this comprehensive law that deal with the individual, with the family, with the community, with the state, with the globe, international relation. All this. This is miracles by itself. And there are many things, many miracles of the book that we need to learn about it. Muslim will be able, when you know more about the Quran, you will be more able to defend the Quran. Why? Because the enemy of Islam, they throw many allegations. They say, for example, one of the allegations, they said, well, you see the story of the Quran, it was taken from the old books like the Bible, subhanAllah. So when you know this, you will be able to defend the Quran and said, look at what the Quran and look what is there. How come, subhanAllah, the Quran who come late and come with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who didn't live at the time of the previous revelation, he was able to bring the correct stories, and there's no contradiction, which was found in previous books. So how come somebody will copy from a book that has many contradictions? So, and there's many of like this thing, so you can defend the Quran in front of the end of the Quran. So, جزاكم الله خير بارك الله فيكم. I hope that we cover this topic. Sorry if I threw too many information today, because I was trying to finish this introduction today. So next week we'll talk about introduction in tafsir, and then the following week, inshallah, we'll start tafsir Surat Al-Fatih. Barakallahu wa khair. I leave some time for you for your question or comment. جزاكم الله خير. If anyone have a question, he can raise hand, and our admin, may Allah Azza wa Jalla reward her, she will give him the chance to unmute his mic, and he can talk, or she talk now. Any question? Any comment? Right. Anyway, we still maybe of this too much information that got, you need to go back to work in or to review the notes that you wrote, and then maybe you will have other questions. We can ask it next week, no problem, inshallah. Barakallah feekum, jazakum Allah khair. At the end, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase us all in the knowledge of the deen and the knowledge of the Quran. We have Brother Ahmed here, his hand, yes, now. Go, Brother Ahmed. Ahmed Muhammad.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh.
I wanted to ask if, since you brought it up, مثلاً the Dead Sea or Madain Saleh, is it allowed for us to go there if we are any like in a state of contemplation, or is it forbidden 100% to go visit those places?
Well, you know, ulama have a different view related to this regarding if somebody passed by just to, you know, to take a listen from this. But it's not not to stay there, not to, you know, just take it as a picnic and just to stay there for amusement, to get some lesson to remember what happened to these people, inshallah. Some ulama, they said it's okay, and Allah alam.
Jazakallah khair.
Sister Iman, you have a question?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Dr. Yahya.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, sister. Yes.
I just want to know, I don't know, because I was, I went for outside a while ago before when you started the lecture. I just want to check if there will be again any registration for those who are going to attend this course.
You mean what we just
said? Like we did before, we didn't for the registration. Mm-hmm. We will have again registration for this course.
I'm not sure. This is, you know, this is through the administration. Maybe you can check with the, okay. You know, with GDC.
Okay.
Now. Bye. So I think we'll stop here. Barakallah feekum. Anyway, next week you can gather all your questions. You can send it also in the group. We have our group for our brothers in Sikh knowledge. And also, I think the sisters, they have their group. Those brothers and sisters who are not members in the group, they can request this from the admin of this group. Barakallahu feekum wa jazakumullah khair. Well, before I end, please, brother, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase our knowledge in the deen, to bless the Muslim with tranquility and security. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all the sins of all Muslim, the living and the dead. And remind you to make dua for our beloved brother, Ahmed Bradilla. Brother Ahmed, now he's in coma, but he's one of the noble person who work with us at Jeddah Dawah Center. And I know him for more than 3 years. And he was very active in Dawah. He has many students. He was highly respected in Jeddah, especially among the Filipino community. They consider him as Baba, as they call him. And he's really one of the great brothers that I met who devoted all his time for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal and Da'wah, Wallahu Hasibu. So I request from all of you in your prayer at all time to make dua for him, that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cure him and he recovered from this and give him strength in his body and his health. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Azza wa Jal give cure and shifa for all Muslim, and we pray also that he subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon all those brothers and sisters who left this world to the other world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive them. Barakallahu feekum wa jazakumullahu khayran. We have one hand, I see it. I don't know if there's time to. Sister Zainab, go ahead.
Doctor, yeah, assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Doctor, yeah, can I ask, but it is not related in the one you lectured.
No, maybe if it's not related, we'll leave it to other time. Anyway, I would like to remind you that tomorrow, inshallah, tomorrow after Maghrib at 7:30 Mecca time, Saudi time, we will resume our fiqh class. And it will start with the chapter of business, transaction, and trade. So it is very important for every Muslim to know the rules of selling and buying and commercial transaction. Inshallah, we'll start this in Bulugh al-Maram tomorrow. And it will start and it will be continue every Sunday between Maghrib and Isha, Jeddah time, which is about 7:30, inshallah, p.m. So I hope you can ask at that time or next week if we have more time, because it's already now it's been more than 1 hour we spent here. Barakallahu feekum. Jazakumullah khair. See you, inshallah, next week. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Okay. Shukran, Abba.